welcome to Nightcap. I'm Jon Sarlin. We got a great show for you today. First up, companies want employees back in the office. Will workers hit the streets to protest? Then, the death knell for cable, with ESPN reportedly wanting to offer its channel separate from TV packages. Will the media industry's longtime money printer freeze up? And last, corporate greed jacking prices higher. Why greedflation is no longer being dismissed as a fringe theory. But first, are worker walkouts the next phase of the work-from-home battle? Next week, some corporate Amazon workers are planning a walk-off. They're frustrated with the company's return-to-work policies, amongst other issues, and choosing to protest returning to work by leaving work. Some context. This month, Amazon began requiring thousands of employees back into the office at least 3 days a week. Organizers say they will go through with the walkout at Amazon's Seattle headquarters if at least 1,000 workers agree to participate. And it's not just Amazon trying to bring its workers back into the office. Disney, Starbucks, and Lyft are among the companies now offering fewer remote days. So, what does the next phase of the work-from-home battle look like? Ed Zitron is the founder of EZPR, who has written about working from home for The Atlantic in his newsletter, Where's Your Ed At? Ed, so there have been a lot of layoffs at Amazon, and yet still we're seeing workers at Amazon feel strongly enough about working from home to organize this walk-off. Do you think workers have any power here?
They do. And I think that that's something that Amazon is really going to have to get used to. Chris Smalls has proven that unionization is a possibility with Amazon workers, and seeing it on the corporate level, this could have a massive cascade effect for this company. I think Jeff Bezos is overconfident. I think Amazon's management is overconfident. I think they could see a real walkout here, and it could, I don't know if you'll get a corporate unionization, but I certainly hope so.
So worker productivity is down. It fell 2.7 in the first quarter, even though the number of hours worked increased. So some critics like OpenAI CEO Sam Altman have blamed remote work. What do you say to the productivity argument?
I think that that metric is kind of flawed. I think it's too general. I also think that Sam Altman, who makes his money building things on the computer to be used on the computer in a web browser that can be used from anywhere, kind of a hypocrite. I think a lot of these people who have been enriched by this are now exceedingly rich and so disconnected from the workforce that they have no meaningful connection to it and thus really can't speak to the average remote worker or the average knowledge worker's actual output. I see no signs of this in any of the companies I work with. And I believe that you've got a lot of center right adjacent people who are now pushing this idea because they're bored and rich and have nothing else to do.
Well, let me ask you about another one of those very rich people who has that same worldview, Elon Musk. Has been very vocal about hating working from home. He has never really wavered on that. Here's what he recently told CNBC's David Faber.
You're going to work from home, and you're going to make everyone else who made your car come work to the work in the factory. You're going to make the people who make your food that gets delivered that they can't work from home. The people that come fix your house, they can't work from home, but you can. Does that seem morally right?
So there, Elon Musk is making this a moral issue. Is it a moral imperative to have workers work in an office?
I hate to say it, but that is one of the most colossally stupid arguments I've ever heard. No, a food delivery person can't work from home. That's not how time and space works, Elon. Also, Elon Musk runs 3, 4, 5 companies. Boring company barely delivers practices. No, someone working in a car factory can't work from home. It's not a moral issue. If we want to talk about moral issues with Elon Musk, perhaps don't let right-wing psychopaths and Nazis come back on Twitter. Putting that aside, though, this isn't a moral issue. This is a very much a business one.
Do you think we'll see more worker organization around this issue if companies really try to force employees back into the office?
I actually do. And I believe the Writers Guild of America and that whole strike situation is really proving at scale that this kind of vile, poisonous kind of capitalism can be fought with worker unionization and organization. I think we're going to see more of it, and I certainly hope so, and I have solidarity with all of them.
So up next, it might have been the biggest sports news all week, even with Jokic's historic run and LeBron maybe considering retirement. But it didn't happen on TV. The Wall Street Journal reported that ESPN is planning to separate itself from your cable package, offering its channel as a streaming service, no bundle necessary. Now, ESPN's cable divorce would have massive implications, not just for the sports world, but for the entire media business. Here's why. ESPN is the single most valuable part of a cable package. People subscribe to cable to get ESPN. It's got exclusive sports licenses, Sports Center, Stephen A. Smith yelling at J.J. Redick. The top cable channels drive almost all cable subscriptions, so losing ESPN would mean a restructuring of the cable business. So, with ESPN's big move, can anything save the cable package from cord-cutting extinction? Here to discuss is Sara Fischer, senior media reporter at Axios and media analyst for CNN. Sara, a lot of us have had cable for one reason, ESPN. If ESPN were to stream its flagship channel, could the cable business survive that?
It would be very difficult, and I'll explain why. For a long time, we thought that there were two things that were really holding up the cable bundle, which was news and sports. But in the past year, we've come to find that really it's much more heavily weighted towards sports. Moffitt Nathanson, which is a premier analyst firm analyzing media, technology, and entertainment, put out a report last year that said they believe the ceiling, meaning the most amount of people who are going to pay for pay TV, is likely about 55 million, and that ceiling is mostly made up of sports fans. So let's take a look at what sports is within the cable bundle. As you noted, ESPN is by far the most costly channel within the cable bundle, costing over $9 a month. That's astronomical if you consider the fact that most news networks only charge around a dollar. Other sports networks are also pretty expensive, but not that close. You have regional sports networks, so the local cable channels that distribute games from your local teams, and those can be anywhere between, you know, a dollar and maybe $5, but nothing comes close to ESPN. So if you were to remove that from the cable bundle, not only would it disincentivize consumers to continue to subscribe, but it would put the cable companies, those that distribute these channels, in a bind. They no longer would be able to charge those astronomical amounts for those cable bundles, and then no longer would the math make sense for them. If the math doesn't make sense for them, the business doesn't make sense for them, and then all the cable networks underneath no longer have a model for distribution.
Well, let's talk about the math there, because, you know, we've heard about cord cutting for years, this existential threat. Does this mean, you know, that we're reading about ESPN's move? Are we in the end game here? What do you know about the economics behind ESPN's, looking into this?
That's a good question. So right now they offer something called ESPN Plus, which is a streaming service for some live rights, but not the most premier live rights. Meaning if you want to watch Monday Night Football, you still have to subscribe to the cable channel through your pay TV package through a cable provider. What this would be is separating out that cable bundle, that cable subscription, into a separate streaming service. That's not the same thing as ESPN Plus. So what you would get, something like Monday Night Football that's premier, would go into this separate service. As a result, you'd have to price it pretty significantly higher than what you're charging for ESPN Plus, because you can't expect somebody to, you know, spend the same amount that they're getting for just maybe a few soccer games than what they're going to want to get for something like Monday Night Football or even more premier rights. So it would have to be pretty high. Now, what would that number be? Everyone is asking this question. Would it need to be $20, $40, $50? How would you make the math work for ESPN? Obviously, you don't want to have to take on huge losses by paying for huge premiums for sports rights, but then not compensating them with the same type of money that you're getting from sort of a cable subscription fee. So I'm not quite sure how that math would work. But what I do know is this. If you're a cable company and you've been charging people $100 a month for this bundled package, once you no longer have ESPN, and now that a lot of the regional sports networks are starting to face, you know, existential crisis, there's no way you can charge that amount and expect consumers to pay. And so it's just not going to work in terms of their business model. And in terms of timing, to the last point of your question, this is happening on the horizon pretty soon. The last big sports package rights that we have coming up is going to be the NBA rights. Those expire next year. Currently, there's a cable package with TNT, TBS, a few others. If that were to move either all or fully to streaming, expect this cable collapse to happen much sooner.
Last up, a theory embraced by progressives that corporate greed is the driving force behind inflation is now going mainstream. Yes, there are signs that inflation is finally starting to slow down. Prices still rose in April, but not as much as they had been before. So, why is it taking so long for inflation to cool off when the Federal Reserve has hiked interest rates 10 times since last March? Well, progressives for years have been pointing to greedflation, the idea that companies are using higher costs as an excuse to overcharge customers while bringing in record profits. But now, some mainstream economists are now backing that theory. Why? Emily Peck is a markets correspondent at Axios. Emily, you recently wrote about how greedflation used to be dismissed as this fringe conspiracy theory, but is now being taken more seriously. What changed?
What changed is inflation stuck around for a really long time, and the driving factors seem to be disappearing. You know, first we had supply chain snarls driving inflation. Those have largely gone away. Then we had war in Ukraine driving inflation. We all saw gas prices soar. We saw energy prices soar. We understood, okay, prices are still rising because of this war now. Then that stabilized, but prices still stayed high. So there was a natural curiosity and drive to figure out, you know, what's going on here? You know, the driving factors seem to have gone away, and yet inflation is sticking around. So there was a lot more curiosity among a lot of economists to just sort of figure it out.
So practically, you know, what does it mean for economists if you can point to greedflation as what is truly driving inflation?
Well, first of all, let's just say no one's really calling it greedflation anymore. I think serious people tried and call it other stuff. And as you pointed out earlier, it's not the catchiest name, if we're being totally honest.
It's not.
Some people call it profit margin inflation or seller's inflation. And it matters to figure out what's driving inflation, because the big solution we have in the United States for combating inflation is raising interest rates, as you talked about earlier. And usually, or in the past, when we've raised interest rates so much, we've hiked so much, that drives up unemployment. That's a pretty serious consequence, right, of combating inflation. If there's a different cause for inflation, perhaps hiking rates and putting people out of work is not the best solution. So I think there's a drive among certain economists that I've spoken to figure out other ways, innovative ways, that don't involve putting people out of work.
If it really is companies, increasing prices that's driving inflation, let's assume that. Are you surprised that the public has been willing to accept higher prices?
Yeah. I am a little bit surprised, because sometimes the excuses are a company will literally say, inflation's high, so we have to raise prices, which when you kind of think about it, doesn't quite make sense. Are they saying their input costs have gone up? And companies in earnings calls have been saying the consumer is willing to accept higher prices. We've been able to keep customers buying our products even though we're hiking prices. This has been among a lot of different consumer product companies. I think Pepsi is an example, the meat processors, you know, they've all said consumers will take it. And as to why, it's because, you know, we've lived through a really weird and crazy time. And at first, inflation really was because of these supply chain issues and because of increased demand. You know, a lot of people had lots more money to spend. And so there was just an expectation that prices were going up. And that's sort of the perfect moment for seller's inflation, or yes, greed inflation, to kind of take hold, because people are willing to believe that prices are going up, not because companies are greedy, but because that's what's happening.
So that's all from us. Don't forget to sign up for the Nightcap newsletter at cnn.com/nightcap. And join us again next week at 4 p.m. Eastern right here at CNN Business. Thanks for watching.